Hi everyone, today I'm going to do a cookie tutorial on how to make some really lovely Christmas cookies. I'm going to show you how to decorate them. I'm actually doing this for a fundraiser for one of my lovely students, Mel. And I've known Mel for almost 9 years now. And Mel has been to a few of my classes. Well, she's been to many classes. But Mel's been facing the big C this year, and she's had an operation, and now she's having treatment to combat it. So I'm actually not going to charge for the tutorial that's going to be linked to my website. So it's a I'm going to actually show you what it's all about. So it's actually a 5-page printable tutorial. It's got the lovely vanilla cookie recipe. It's also going to show you how I make piping gel, and then it's got my step-by-step instructions on how to decorate the cookies. So at the end of this live Facebook feed, I'm going to ask you, if you're happy and want to download it, I'm going to ask you to go onto the link that I've done and make a donation to Mel's fund. It can be a little donation or it can be a big donation, but it doesn't really matter the size, it's doing it that counts. So wherever you may be in the whole world, I wish you all a wonderful Christmas, and I am going to show you how to make some lovely cookies. But the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to make piping gel. And I'm going to just move the camera down a little bit and then bring it up. Okay, so piping gel, what is it and why do we need it? So basically, piping gel is a great medium to use on your baked cookie to attach your fondant to the cookie. You can buy piping gel commercially, but generally I make my own. And I make it in a batch, and sometimes I will double or quadruple the recipe. And then I will make the batch, and then I'll put it in smaller containers, and then I shall freeze it, okay? Now, piping gel, you can actually colour it blue, all different colours. So if you want a water effect on a cake, for instance, like a swimming pool, or if it's a fishing pond and you want to make a nice sort of wet looking coloured water effect, piping gel is a wonderful product. You can also pipe with piping gel, and we can add paste gel colours to it, and you can pipe with it. You can also pipe with it and then paint gold or silver on top. But the downside of using piping gel on our cakes or to pipe on an inscription on a board or a cookie, it sometimes remains tacky, so it doesn't thoroughly dry. So in the recipe that I'm going to give you, now I will say this slowly, but there won't be any recipe at the end of this. So in my recipe sheet to make the piping gel, we basically just need 4 simple ingredients. I'm going to sound like that woman that's got that book out. We're going to use 1/4 cup of water. We're going to use 1/4 cup of lemon juice. And then we're going to use 1/3 cup of sugar. And then we need 1 tablespoon of corn flour. So I'm going to move my camera down, and you will get to see, hopefully, all of the ingredients. Let me just adjust this. Okay, so what I've basically got is, now I'm using lemon juice, and you can, if you want to, use freshly squeezed lemon juices, you know, lemons, and then squeeze them. But I'm actually using a bottled lemon juice, and you can buy that in most supermarkets. And then what I've got is, I've measured all my ingredients out. Now, if you've been watching some of my tutorials, you'll notice that I tend to weigh everything out. So basically what I've got is I've got a quarter of a cup of water, I've got 1/4 cup of lemon juice, and then I've got 1/3 cup of sugar. Now if you've got caster sugar, which is a little bit finer, I recommend that than the granulated. But if you've only got granulated, that's fine. You can, if you want to, put it in a food processor and just break it down a bit, but that's fine. And then what we're going to do, we're going to need 1 tablespoon of corn flour. Now at the end, if you notice, let me show you my piping gel, it's got a bit of a yellow tinge to it because I actually add vanilla extract to it, okay? So you can flavour it as well, And I'm going to explain to you how to store it and how to look after it as well. Now, can I have a few thumbs up? I've got a few viewers watching. Can I have a few thumbs up or likes just to come across the screen so I can see that you're hearing me? Any thumbs up, anyone? Now, tools that I need. I need a heatproof measuring jug. I'm also going to need a tablespoon. And I'm also going to need a whisk. Now, these are silicone whisks. They're awesome. They're very lightweight. So I really, really do like these. Now, I will be doing this in the microwave method, but if you wanted to, you could put it in a saucepan and you could melt it in the saucepan, okay? But I find the microwave method is just great, you know? So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put my water. Now, the water doesn't have to be freezing cold, but I'm just using water that's come out of a filter. Some of our water here in Australia, it's got lots and lots of bits in it, so I always use filtered water. So I'm going to put the water in the jug. I'm going to put the sugar into the jug, okay? And I'm just going to swirl it around a little bit, okay? And then what I've got is I've got my lemon juice in here. I'm going to put about half of my lemon juice into the pan. And then what I want to do, I'm going to add a tablespoon of corn flour. Now, some people call this corn starch. And if you watch this and you're in America, welcome. Welcome, everyone. But we use it corn flour here in Australia. So I'm adding a tablespoon of my corn flour. And I want to mix this into a paste, okay? So don't mix this straight into your mixture because you'll have lumpy, bumpy bits, okay? And it should look like a nice light cream, I suppose. Probably won't taste like cream, okay? And then I'm going to pour that all into the jug. Don't waste it. Make sure you get all of that corn flour mixture in there, okay? And then what I'm going to do, I'm actually just going to stir this slightly. Now, the plan is I'm going to lift up my camera and I'm going to take this to the microwave. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to microwave that for 2 minutes just to begin with, okay? Now, if you do this in a saucepan, you want it on a really, really low heat, okay? Because what will happen is you'll find that the sugar might catch on the bottom of the pan and it will catch and it will burn, okay? The other thing is, realistically, you should always, if you do it in a pan, you want to put it on a smaller ring or a hob, so you're not cooking it on a really, really big ring, you know, according to the size of the pan. Now, I'm going to wait for 2 minutes, but I've set it for 20 minutes. And I'm going to take it out and then I will stir it, because what we don't want to have is any lumps in this piping gel, okay? So I'm going to give it 2 minutes. I'm not going to sing any Christmas carols yet. You need to be careful when you take it out because it will start to warm up, okay? And you can see it's just a bit of a frothy mixture, okay? So give it a stir and we're going to cook it for 2 more minutes. Now, whilst it's cooking, I want to explain to you about storage. Now, you can store it in a fridge up to about 3 to 4 weeks. Generally, I only keep it in the fridge for 2 weeks. And what I tend to do is I actually store it in larger containers, but when I'm ready to use it, I decanter it and I put it into some smaller containers so that I don't get any crumbs into the mixture. Hello, I got Shidra. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you, my lovely. So I'm going to wait 2 more minutes, and we're about a minute in. Okay, and you can see it's, can you see it's starting to froth up? Okay, and it will start to go clearer. Okay. Okay. Now this is how we used to make a gel for our flans and our desserts back at college. Okay. So we made a fruit flan, so a sponge with lots of fruit on top. We would add a liqueur normally, a touch of Malibu or Archer's. And now you must be very, very careful when taking it out the microwave because it can bubble up and it can become hot. So always be cautious when you're in and around that microwave. Now, with the container, make sure your container is nice and strong and sturdy. Some of the takeaway containers that I use just to store light things aren't always suitable because they tend to crack and split when they get cold. So you want to make sure they're a food safe container. Now you might wonder where I get these lovely from, and you know where I'm going to say, don't you? IKEA. I'm about 5 minutes up the road from IKEA, so you know. Now these are $3 for a set of three, and they've actually changed the design. They're round ones, but what's awesome, they're Jackie proof, so I can drop them on the ground and they won't split and crack. Okay. Now if I start to show you the mixture now, can you see it starting to go whiter? It's going to start to go clearer. Okay. Now at college, we used to use arrowroot, which is a little bit more refined than corn flour. But can you see now I've got a really nice, thick, gloopy mixture, okay? I'm gonna give it 1 more minute. Now, usually when I make this recipe, I will quadruple it and I will make quadruple the amount because realistically, this amount is perfect for about 20 cookies, you know. You don't need a lot, but I normally quadruple the recipe. Okay, so I'm just going to give that a stir. And I'm very content with that. And I will add flavouring at the end. I won't add the flavouring now. I will wait until it's cool and then I will work it in. I'm just going to get a spatula, and what I'm going to do, I'm going to pour it into my clean container. Now, as this cools down, it will actually start to thicken. And as it starts to thicken, it will also become a little bit more glossier, okay? But if you think this is just too thick, and you'll see the consistency in a minute. If you think it's too thick, you can thin it down with some water that's cooled and it's been boiled, okay? Now, if you have a look at the two colors, can you see they're very different? This one is very, very yellower, and that one is whiter, okay? Now, if you're going to make a blue effect on a cake, then you don't need to put any vanilla extract into it. But I add about 1/4 teaspoon of vanilla extract, and that is how, that's why it always comes up slightly coloured, okay? So that is how I make my piping gel. Okay, next, I'm going to show you how to decorate your cookies. So, what we're going to do, I'm going to show you a few different ways of decorating cookies. Now, I'm going to show you a classic Christmas tree. Got a bit of a broken star, but that's okay. I'm going to show you how to make these cute little gifts. Okay, and I'm also going to show you how to make a bauble. I don't even know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but a Christmas tree bauble. Now, this one is actually on a stick, and I've actually used a bauble-shaped cookie cutter. And you might find that you don't have those cookie cutter shapes, okay? Because basically it's a circle and it's got a lower point. But if you don't have this style of cookie cutter, and most of these cutters I've used are sweet-themed cookie cutters, but if you don't have a bauble cutter, you can simply use a round cutter, okay? So So I'm going to show you how to make the Christmas tree. I'm going to show you how to make the really cute little decorative parcel, and I'm going to show you the little ways of making the little Tiffany bows, and I'm going to show you how to make the bauble. Now, with the Christmas bauble, I've actually cooked it on a cookie stick. Now, you can, if you want to, cook them on skewers, and then you can hot glue ribbon around them to make them prettier, but you need to make sure you're using oven-proof cookie sticks, okay? Now, there's various companies that make them, and the ones I tend to buy, the ones from Sweet Themes, and they have them there. Now, if you're in America, you can go to places like Wilton is a brand, and you can Michaels, I think, is the I love Michaels, but you can buy all the cookie sticks from there as well, and you can buy them mainly online. But you want to make sure they are the baking cookie sticks and not just for lollies and stuff, because otherwise they will melt. Okay, now there's a few cake tools that you're going to need to make all these decorations, okay? And I'm just going to move the camera down a little bit more so you can see what I'm up to. Okay, so what cake tools do we need? Now, I find when I store all my cake tools, I find these little cutlery trays are perfect for putting all your bits and bobs in, okay? I'm just gonna adjust the camera a little bit more. Okay, so what I've got in here is I've got a small little dish of water. I've got a medium-sized rolling pin. I've got a pizza wheel cutter, okay? I've got a small pair of scissors. Now make sure your scissors are just for your cake decorating, okay? No cutting toenails, no cutting fringes, just for you, no one else. And I've got a stitching tool wheel cutter as well. If you didn't have that, I'm going to show you another tool that you could use instead, okay? I'm going to use a cranked or angled palette knife. And then what I've got also is a tiny little star cutter as well, okay? A few other things I'm going to need. I'm going to use an artist brush. Now, these I buy, you can buy these in Michaels in America. Here in Australia, you can buy them in Spotlight. And what's brilliant about them is they're plastic handled. So if you put them in a sink, they won't split and crack. So they're not made of paint, they're made of plastic. And I actually use them to model with as well. So I'm getting a few questions in there. Hello from Texas, thank you for doing this. You're very much welcome, Dana. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, I'm going to just lift the camera up a little bit more, but I'm gonna bring it down. I was gonna sneakily bribe my son to come in and do this today, but I think he's out Christmas shopping. I hope he's out Christmas shopping. Okay. All right. I think you can see all well. Wonderful. Okay, now, the next thing I want to really talk to you about is fondant. Now, with fondant, ideally, what we should do is we should colour it up the day before we actually need it, okay? Now, with fondant, you'll find that you can create some really beautiful Christmassy colours. And what I've done is I've used Merry Colour pastel colours. You can use Wilton, there's all different brands. But what I've also got is I've got some strong red. And I've also got a really nice green colour as well. Okay. Later on, I'm going to show you about painting with edible paints. And there's a few other things I'm going to be showing you as well. So I've got some fondant already coloured. I'm going to quickly show you how to colour fondant for those that may not know how to colour fondant. There's a few other tools I'm going to use. I'm going to use some acrylic spacers. These are 3mm spacers, and I'm going to lay them on my board when I roll out, and I'm going to actually roll the fondant out. So the fondant actually only goes to a depth of 3mm, okay? The other thing I'm going to recommend you doing is buying a pastry brush just for your cake making or your cookie making. When you buy your brush, what I want you to do is to put the kettle on when you get home and pour a big mug or cup of hot water and then put your pastry brush in there. What that will do is there's glue inside this, and this will shrink and it will make the hairs tighter. And what that means is you're going to have less hair loss when you use your brush, okay? When you wash your brush, you also want to leave it, wash it and then leave it. And I generally leave it on top of a cup or a bowl, and I let it air dry. Don't leave it in a container downwards, because often it starts to harbour bugs and stuff. Now, before you use your brush, pretend you're a hairdresser and give it a bit of a flick, a bit of a style, and make sure that it is nice and not losing hairs, okay? Don't be using this to marinate the steaks on the barbie, okay, or for pastry work. Just keep it separate for your cakes, okay? We've got lots of thumbs up here. Good. All right, I'm not going to read all the questions or comments, but I will answer some at the end. Now, I want to talk to you about how to colour up your fondant, okay? So, I've got some white here, and with our fondant, we need to really make sure that we store it away airtight. Think of fondant as cheese. You must store it airtight, wrapped up, and away from direct sunlight, because it will also fade. Now, when we buy our fondant, there are many different brands, and I suggest you buy the brand that is made locally to you. Some of our overseas brands are incredibly sticky, and we're getting lots and lots of brands coming through, but realistically, our hot climate here in Australia is very different from the British temperature, and America, and if you're in Greece, we're all different. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I'm just going to condition the fondant, just going to warm it up, and then I'm going to just show you with a very small piece. I'm going to flatten it like a bit of focaccia bread. Okay, and then what we're going to use, we're going to use a paste gel colour, okay? Now, you can buy these at most cake decorating stores. If you're in San Antonio, I've got to give out a shout for Rebecca's shop, Sheer Celebrations. If you live in Australia, we have many cake decorating stores. Generically, we have Spotlight, and you can buy most of your products there. So what I've done is I've dipped my toothpick into the colour, and I've just folded it up like a little samosa, okay? Now, if I was in England, I'd be calling it my Cornish pasty, but we're not in England. So what I like to do is I like to just use the tips of my fingers to work it through. I always explain to my students, when you're using a small amount, don't use your hands, because your hands will heat it up very, very quick. In the UK, it's really chilly at the minute. It's also chilly in Italy. If Barbara's listening, she's probably got blankets on top of her as she watches this. But what I suggest you do is to warm up your fondant between the tips of your fingers. In England, if your hands are cold, you warm your hands up, yeah? And if you do that with your fondant, you'll make it too warm. So I like to just use the tips of my fingers and work it through, okay? Now, if I wanted to, I could actually not have rolled it up so much, and I could have actually, if I just roll that out now, can you see there's a slight marbly effect, but I've over kneaded it. But basically, if you don't knead it in too much, you can achieve a really nice marbled effect. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to roll it on a sausage. I'm going to cut it in half, and I'm going to check in the middle. And that's a lovely solid colour. So now, I'm just going to pop that back in my bag. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to show you how to decorate is the Christmas tree. And this is a lovely, lovely, lovely cookie. And what I like to do is I like to use kitchen paper towel. And I'm going to place my cookie tray here so that you can see. Okay. And the first thing I want to do is I want to put some piping gel onto my cookie. Now, what I like to do is to put a small amount of piping gel into my little dish, okay? That way, if I pick up crumbs, which I might do, I wanna not make sure that I put crumbs in the rest of the batch, okay? So I just get a small amount. And with my brush, I'm just gonna do a light brush, okay? and I'm going to dip the brush into the piping gel. And what I want to do is not go right to the edge. I want to keep that edge all along there very, very dry. Because what will happen is when I place the fondant on, it's going to push it over to that edge. And when it pushes it over to that edge, if there's loads of piping gel on that edge, it's going to come out all the way around the side. Okay? So now, I'm just piping or brushing a very, very small amount over the entire cookie. But again, not on that edge. Okay? Now, I only ever do one or two cookies at a time. Now, today's demo, I'm just doing one cookie of each design. But if I was going to do a couple of, 20 cookies, I would do 2 to 3 cookies brushed with piping gel at a time. Piping gel will eventually dry out, so be aware it can dry out, okay? Now, I've got a really, really strong green here, and really, it's a bit too strong for my liking. So what we can do with our fondant, we can actually mix colours. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to tone that green down, and I'm going to pop a little bit of white with it. If we wanted to, we can create colours from colours. Now I've already used a Merry Colour, and it's like an electric green, and it's really bright green. But if I wanted to, I could add a little bit more yellow to this and make a really nice lime green colour. Now, I am going to need with my hands now, because I'm going to have a larger amount here. And as I need, can you see that the colour has become a lighter colour compared to that green? Okay. So we can create lighter colours with our colours by combining, okay? You do not need to buy every single colour of paste gel, okay? You only need to buy your primary colours, and then, some colours are easier to make, and others are more difficult, okay? Now, the next thing you're going to need the same size cookie cutter, as to decorate. So, the reason why I was a bit late doing this, my apologies, I could not find this cutter. And guess what? It was in the first place that I looked. If my husband or son watches this, they'll be going, So what I'm going to do, I'm going to just roll out the fondant, I'm going to scoop it up, and I'm going to put all my seams underneath. I'm rolling out on a Corian board. You can use flexi chopping boards, you can use all different types, but this board is wonderful for rolling out on. And I'm just going to roll north to south a couple of times. And what this is doing, it's allowing the spacers for my rolling pin just to rest on top. Can you see? Now, you can buy rolling pins with spacers on, but little circles. But the downside of those is you can't roll out large pieces, okay? So these are the 3mm acrylic spacers, and they are awesome. Now, when I've rolled out my fondant, I actually want to make sure it's released off and it's not sticking. So before I get excited and cut out my Christmas tree, I want to just make sure that is free. Now, if I wanted to, I could still roll this out a little bit thinner, but I'm at 3mm. So can you see that using those spacers allows that fondant to be beautiful and smooth? The other thing that's awesome is that it also stops the groovy lines and marks, okay? Now, occasionally, when we roll out fondant, especially if we've just coloured it up, and ideally, we should colour it up the day before and let it rest. Sometimes we pick up air bubbles. So I've got some acupuncture pins, and I've put some masking tape on them so that if I lose them on my bench, I can see them. You can use plasters, you can use sticky tape. I've got a little air bubble there and one there. So I'm just going to bring it down on a very low angle and stroke it out. The reason why I don't use dressmaking needles is that the pin is about 5 times thicker than an acupuncture pin, okay? So you can still use an upholstery sewing pin, but I find that the acupuncture ones are very, very fine. Now, once I've released the fondant out, I am going to cut out the Christmas tree. I like to push both hands on that, and then what I do is then I always take off the surplus. And then left behind, I've got my lovely little Christmas tree. Now, because I'm going to make the base of the Christmas tree a different colour, I'm actually going to do it with a brown base. What I will do now is I'm actually going to just trim and take that off. So I like to use my pizza wheel. And using my pizza wheel, I'm just going to slice across and take that little bit off. Okay. And then carefully supporting, I'm going to lift up the tree and I'm going to lay the fondant down on top. Okay. Now, the next thing I want to show you is a flexi smoother. Now, a flexi smoother, I make them. They're homemade. And I'm going to show you right now how I make them. But let me just finish this off. So the first thing I want to do is just lightly smooth it over to each edge. And what I love about the kitchen paper, it's like a little turntable. Can you see I can move the cookie round? And it won't damage the cookie. Okay. And what I'm going to do is just lightly push that down so that the cookie is completely covered. Now sometimes if I do cookies for a client, they may ask, especially if I do square ones, they may want a square border of the cookie showing. And I actually just, there's a couple of things that I do. I actually roll out the fondant a little bit thinner, and then that way it doesn't stretch and it actually becomes shorter. Okay. Now, before I show you the flexi smoother, I just want to do the chocolate bit. So I'm just going to get a little bit of chocolate fondant. Now, you might see that I've got a bit of residue on my board. So what I like to do is I don't use a sharp knife. I just use my spacer and I remove that. Okay. Now next I'm going to use some chocolate fondant. The brand I use is a brand called Bake Elves and it's a chocolate icing. It's chocolate fondant. And what's lovely is it's actually chocolate in flavour and it's chocolate in colour. If you check out my website and you see any cars with tyres and trucks or cookies with black icing, I tend to use the chocolate and then I colour it black. That way it doesn't taste so bitter, because when we use black paste, it's very, very bitter. It really has a horrible taste, you know. So I tend to use the chocolate Bake Elves fondant and then I add black paste gel colour to it, okay. So now what I've done is I've rolled out my base for my Christmas tree. I'm going to lift it up and then release it back down. And then again, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut the bottom area out. I don't need to do all the entire cookie, okay? And then using my pizza wheel, I'm just going to cut that and give it a cleaner edging. Now, I've got a little bit of a rough edging there, so I'm just going to neaten that up. And then what I want to do first of all is I want to make sure that the join, can you see I've got a bit of a gap in between here and here. So first of all, I'm going to just use my finger to push that gap together. I always work on the join first and I smooth that so it makes contact. And then with my flexi smoother, I'm just going to hold the cookie and I'm slowly going to work the fondant down. Okay. So I'm not going to stretch it in two sections. Okay, and then you can just use that just to smooth back. But can you see I've got no piping gel oozing out. The next thing I want to do is make a nice decorative pattern, and I call it my little garland. And what I like to do is I like to start at one corner and I just curve it down. And then I start on another corner and then I curve that down. Now, if you did not have a stitching tool, A, put it on your Christmas gift list. You can use a toothpick and a pair of scissors. And what I'm going to do, I'm just going to snip the end off, okay? And you can use a toothpick instead, okay? So with the toothpick, make sure it's got the cut edge off, and then if I wanted to, I can just dot it. Okay, it's not exactly as the other one, but can you see, I can still do a dotted effect. And I used to use that years ago for all my stitch work on my handbags I used to make, okay? So, next, I am going to use the end of my paintbrush. Now, earlier I spoke to you about paintbrushes. What I love about these are not wooden handled, you know? This is a wooden handle, and eventually, once it goes into the sink, it can sometimes start to swirl and the paint can flake. So what I like about the plastic ones is I can use them for modeling as well. So with the Christmas tree, what I tend to do is I just divide it in the center and I push down. And then I divide that halfway over and I push down, and I divide it halfway and I push down. And then once I've done that, I just bring these out a little bit more of an angle. Okay, and if I find that my bottom, always mention my bottom, but if I find that my bottom is pulling out slightly, I'll just neaten that up, okay, because we need a nice neat bottom. Now, I'm going to put some decorative balls in here. Now, you can use all different types. You can use coloured cashew balls. You can do all different types. I'm going to use some candy balls. And I don't use any water to apply them in, and I'll show you how I do that. So just one tick. Now I've got some really nice Christmassy ones. There's the sugar pearls, I've got the candy pearls, and I've also got some green ones, okay? So you can use all sorts. You could use the little silver balls if you wanted to, but what I'm going to do, I'm just going to pop a few into the dish. And some white ones. Now, how I like to do this is I like to use the end of the paintbrush. So I just tap, tap, and I make sure the paintbrush is really in a nice upright position. Okay, and then very gently, I just simply drop the balls in position. And you don't have to have everything, you know, in, and do it quite random. I've got a couple joined up. I think they must be lucky. Okay, now, once they're in position, I like to use my flexi smoother and I just lay it gently on top and I push them down. You can, if you want to, just use the back of your nail to push down. I've got a double one there. It looks like a red pill for bad backs or something. Okay, I'm just going to pop one in there. Okay. I'm just going to get a little bit of yellow. I'm going to use a really small little star cutter. Now, when I use the cutter, I always make sure I lift up the fondant and then make sure you use the single side, not the ridged edge. If you find that it is sticking, you can actually use corn flour to tap it in, and then I just push down and then lift up. Okay. Now we're going to use a small amount of water to attach the star. And what I do is just pop a little bit of water in that top section. Now when we pick up our stars, make sure we don't mash it to bits. So I just gently lift it up, and I just use my brush to lift it up. So that's my little Christmas cookie, okay? Now in the tutorial, I also show you a different method. I show you how to do strands as well. And I'm gonna just quickly show you how I do that. So what I normally do is I choose a couple of colors. And instead of the cookie having the lines, what I do is I just take a small piece of fondant, roll it, and I roll it in between my hands. Okay, and then I just roll it thinner. And just make it really nice and thin, so it's not overly chunky, okay? Sometimes I will use a cake smoother, and I will just roll that even thinner, okay? And if you want to, instead of marking the lines with the stitching tool, you can run a line of water, and you can lay these overlapping, so it looks like little garlands on the Christmas tree, okay? So in the tutorial, the downloadable tutorial, and I will put a link up on the site once this becomes, I'll load this back up, so you can see what that looks like, okay? Now, any questions? Any questions? I've probably got a few questions, very cute. If you've got any questions, just put them up and I will start to look at them. So type away, okay? But if you haven't got any questions, that's fine. I will check in and check questions, long as it's not Christmas Day, but I will be checking questions. So if you've got any questions, just ask away, okay? Next, I want to show you how to make the Christmas bauble, okay? I posted earlier, Dana, I can only see like two posts at a time, so type in what you want to ask because it only shows a small little box of the questions. So I can't see. So if you want to ask me now, live, I will be able to answer it. So what's the difference between modelling chocolate and fondant? Yeah, so modelling chocolate is normally it's melted chocolate and normally it's glucose. It depends on what the recipe. So modelling chocolate is made out of actual chocolate. And then some people add glucose, some people add tylose, and we basically use it to model, rather than chocolate fondant. So fondant realistically is something that would cover a product, and then we can add tylose for strength. I make marshmallow fondant, is that okay? Yes it is, Dana. In my book, I have a recipe for making my own, but marshmallow is fine. We just find it very sticky here in Australia, but I'm up in Queensland and it's really, really hot. But if you're further up, it's even hot. And apparently Sydney was 39 yesterday. So we're just sharing the heat if you're in Sydney, so you should be thanking us for sharing our heat. But if it's a hot climate, marshmallow is really, really sticky for humidity, okay? There's a difference between hot weather and then there's a difference between humidity, okay? And our humidity can get up to 70-80%. So further up north, I have students that come down and they can't put the washing out on the line because it's just too wet for the washing to dry. Got more questions coming up. Here people find it's store-bought and it's not very tasty. Yeah, I know. That's why, Dana, it's good to make your own. And then once you get a really great product, you know, can you freeze it if you make a big batch? So you can, you know, you can break it up, cut it up. I'm on the Gulf of Mexico, yeah, and it's hot. It's very humid, yeah. So I suppose, do you have to put a lot of corn flour in to roll it out? I'm a bit anti-corn flour. I try not to put too much. In fact, I don't use it at all. I use it to dust my hands sometimes, but I very rarely ever. When I was in Miami, I had to use corn flour to roll out, but it was really sticky, you know? So anyway, I'm gonna show you how to make this lovely little Christmas bauble. So let's carry on, okay? So if you have any questions, you can type them in, but be aware I'm not going to be able to answer them straight away. Okay. So the next cookie that I'm going to make is the bauble cookie. Okay, now at the moment I am just using a round circle baked cookie. As I explained earlier, we could use a proper bauble shaped cookie, which basically has a lower point and it's got a nice top. But we're going to add the top to it. Now on this cookie on sticks, I've actually rolled out my cookie dough a little bit thicker. Now for all my cookies, I roll out my cookies to 6 mil thick and I tape two spaces together. And I tape them with masking tape and I roll out my cookie dough so that all my cookies are 6 mil thick. That way they're a nice thickness, they're not too chunky, but also they're not too fragile and will break. However, when I make the cookie dough is another stick deep, so it's 9 mil. So I put three of these together either side and roll out my cookie dough, okay? And you can make them all different sizes. So this is what I wanted to show you. You can do your decorations like that, or you can have your decorations like this, okay? So, for the Christmas cookie, the first thing that we are going to do is I'm going to get a small amount of piping gel again on my brush. Notice when I load up the brush, I don't dip it all the way in, I only dip the tip. And I'm going to just brush, not right over to the edge, okay? So just a small amount. Okay. And what I need to find is a suitable size circle cutter. So these cutters you can buy at most cookware stores. And I am going to choose that size cookie cutter. Okay. Now, in order to get the stripe effect, what I'm going to do is make a base for it to begin with. So, I'm going to use some white, because the white is an easy product colour to use. So, I'm going to just condition the fondant, and just give it a slight push. All my folds, all my joins go underneath, okay? And then when I roll north to south, and I give it a quarter of a turn. North to south, quarter of a turn. And when I roll, I actually stop at the top and the bottom. I call them love handles. You may not know what they are, but they're little fat chubby bits. And I call them on my fondant, so it helps me keep the shape going. Now, once I've got to that thickness, what I want to do is I actually want to roll it out a bit thinner, okay? Because I'm going to do a double layer, okay? So I'm going to cut that circle out. I'm going to give it a slight wiggle, and I'm going to take the excess away. Pop that back into your bag. Now the next thing I'm going to show you is a letter file. You can buy these at most stationery shops, okay? I've got a long questioning coming up. Okay, so what I've got here is a letter file, and basically you can buy these in stationery shops. And what I will do is just gently pick this up and lay on top and lay a sheet on top to stop it drying out. Now, to achieve this effect, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut out some strips. And what I would like to do, I am going to get some of my blue and I'm going to knead it up, just using the tips of my fingers, because I don't need to make it over sticky. And I'm just going to roll it out to my 3 mil thickness, okay? And I'm just going to place that in between these sheets. I'll also do some green. So you can colour coordinate these if you want to. You may not want to colour coordinate them. Now this is very long, so I'm just going to reduce that. And again, I'm going to just pop that under my plastic wrap. Now with my red is very strong in colour. It's really strong. So little is better than too much. Can you see how red that's starting to make the board? Okay, and I'm just going to roll out again. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to lay the white circle on there. And then using my pizza wheel, I'm going to cut some thin lines. Now you can make these different sizes. And in this cookie, I've done some wide green and I've done some narrow yellow, okay? And then here, I'm just going to neaten that edge. Now I find a pizza wheel a really clever tool. It's brilliant for kids so they can't cut themselves, and it's brilliant for us adults so that we can't cut ourselves, okay? So now if I was doing say four or five, say six cookies at a time, I would cut out all my stripes and I would do a group effort, okay? So the first thing I'm going to do is I've got my circle. And I'm just going to get a small amount of water, and I'm doing a zigzag of water on that circle. And then I'm going to lay a blue. I'm going to lay a strip of red. And then I'm going to do green. They all need to be butted up close to each other. Okay, and I'm going to leave that top bit spare, okay? And then I'm going to use that circle cutter and I'm going to cut through all of those again. Give them a wiggle and take all your offcuts away. Looks a bit psychedelic, doesn't it? Now I'm going to use my letter file just to lift that up. Okay, and then what I can do is I can put my letter file on top and I can use my smoother just to smooth that on there, or I can use my flexi smoother and I can just bring that together. Okay, and then very gently I'm going to lay that. So I'm just going to flip it over. So can you see it's got the backing circle, and I'm going to flip it over very gently and lay that in position. Ooh. And you get an ooh. I really wish I had audio so I could hear you. Maybe it's not, maybe it's good that I can't hear you. So now I'm just gonna use my smoother and I'm gonna smooth it. A few years ago, I did a planetarium cookie and they were celebrating a science thing, and I actually made the planets, and I made, you know, okay. I've got a couple of questions coming up. Hi, Anita, how are you? All the way from San Antonio. Or Houston, I'm trying to think, is it Houston or San Antonio? Okay. Now, obviously, I have not used the same cutter as this one, because this bauble has got that effect on the top. So what I'm going to do, because I'm going to paint this yellow, I'm going to use a yellow piece of fondant. And I've actually got some gold fondant coloured up, so I'm just going to get that. Okay. And then what I want to do, I'm just going to lay that back on there. And I'm going to wipe my bench, because it has picked up lots and lots of colour. So I'm just using a piece of kitchen paper towel. Okay, so I'm going to roll out my gold. And then what I want to do is I'm just going to cut a little square. But I'm just going to taper it slightly. Okay. And I'm just going to reduce it down, because it is a little bit too big. And we'll use a tiny amount of water. And I'm going to pop it on. So it's just like a little crystal bauble. Now, to add to this design, and if you know what I'm like, I'm always adding more. What I want to show you next is I want to use some really, really, really nonpareils. I really don't know how that even came about. Do you reckon they were like working it out one day? Oh, let's come up with something complex and call it nonpareils. Now, what I want to do is I want to put some little sprinklings across, you know. And if I wanted to, I could actually dust this with edible luster to get a nice luster colour. But what I will do is I'm going to use my piping gel. Okay. And I'm going to use a thinner brush. And I'm going to mix a small amount of the piping gel with a little bit of water. And I'm going to thin it down just a little bit. So just get a little dish. And just pop a bit of piping gel into the dish, and then just get a little bit of water and just do a few little taps of water, and we're going to let it down. Okay, so you may be asking, well, why didn't she want you to just use the piping gel? The piping gel is just a little bit too thick, and I want it to be a little bit thinner. Okay, so I'm going to dip my brush into some water. Better put my glasses on so I can see what I'm doing. Now, if I wanted to, I could just do some small dots. A dot there, a dot there, a dot there. Okay? I could do a dot there. I could go very dotty. But if I wanted to, I could do a line across. Notice I'm using the same brush, but I'm just flipping it over. Okay? So I've got a line, and then I'm just going to go back in and just re-dot those dots. You know where I'm going with this, don't you? Okay, now, you've got to do it on a dish. If you don't do it on a dish, you'll be in trouble. I am going to do it in a flatter dish, so you'll see what I mean. Okay, I'm going to angle it in there, and I'm just going to drop my balls. terrible when I say that, isn't it? And can you see? Ooh la la! Looks cute. You like it? I love it. Okay, so that looks a lovely Christmas bauble. Okay, so I'm going to leave that to dry. Now the tricky bit is getting your balls back into the container. And sometimes if I've got lots, I'll just shoot it in into a piece of paper. But can you see I've just done it like that? So you can make really cute little decorations on your Christmas baubles. The next thing I want to show you is how to make these cute little Christmas cookies, but they are like a little Christmas gift. I'm going to have a quick tidy up. Not that quick, but a tidy up nonetheless. So far, what have we got? We have got our Christmas tree and our Christmas bauble. Okay, so how do I make this little cute cookie? So the first thing I'm going to need, and I'm going to do this twice, okay? If you also find that your edges have not come up clean on your cookie, you can just use a non-sharp knife and just use a dish, and you can just lightly neaten that up. Okay, so use a clean piece of kitchen paper, towel, and we're going to use our brush. The brush must not be overly loaded, so just use the tip. And remember, we're going to keep the edge totally dry. No piping gel on that edge. Okay. We're going to be a bit stingy and not put any piping gel on that edge. Notice I'm only using the top section of the brush. Okay. Now, to make this, what looks really nice is again, we use coordinated colours. So, I am going to use some blue and some green. So, with the coloured fondant, I'm just going to knead it up, and I need to choose a suitable square cutter that's going to fit the cookie. Okay, so using the same cookie cutter that you've used at the beginning, and then I'm going to roll out the fondant, roll it out north to south. Okay, release it and make sure it's not sticking. Now what I want to do is I want to cut roughly the square, but I don't want to cut it exactly. And then I'm going to place it between two letter files. And I'm going to do one green one and I'm going to do one blue one. So these are lovely to make for 21st birthday cakes or baby showers. And you can do little flowers. You can do butterflies, you can cut out numbers, and you can, you know, you can really make beautiful cookies for this. So if you've just joined us, at the beginning of this video, I showed you how to make piping gel. So you can make your own piping gel, you don't need to buy any commercial. And then I've also shown you just a few different techniques. Now, this tutorial will be available for you to download from my website, and the purpose of this is really just to raise some money for my good friend and student Mel, who's just been recovering from the big C. And I'm going to put a link in for you to see, and if you'd like to download the tutorial, I'm going to ask you to make a donation to Mel's page. Doesn't have to be a huge amount of money, but I'd like a donation if you want to, you know, get the tutorial. So now with the white, there are many ways of doing this. You can roll out your white, because I'm going to do a nice little polka dot effect on here. But as it's Christmas, what I want to do is maybe do a combo of both. So I am going to roll out my white, and I'm going to roll it out thinner. Okay. Now these are my, they're antiques now, these are my pastry cutters from years ago. And I could use a piping tip, but I'm actually a metal piping tip, but I'm going to use my little circle cutters. And what I find really easy is to roll out the fondant. And then you can just simply place it on your sheet, and then you can cut out your circles. If it sticks, you can just tap it out. And sometimes, if I make pirate ships, I actually let it stick so that I can make piles of money and coins. The other thing you can do is with the corn flour, you can just tap it into the corn flour and then... Now I only want a few of these circles, and then I just simply lift that back, and then I've got my dots. Now once I've got my dots, I am going to lay my dots onto my fondant. I do not have to stick them on with any water, okay? So you can do this with butterflies, you could do this with flowers, you could do this with numbers. You can go crazy and do all different patterns, okay? The other thing is, if you don't want to do the pastry cutter, you can simply take a tiny piece of fondant and roll it into a ball and then just drop it. Take a tiny piece and drop it. Take a tiny piece and just drop it. Okay. I'm going to just cover that for the moment, and I want to just do a few more, but in the red. Now, as the red is kind of very tacky, I'm just going to do a few, and I pinch it, and I use this part of my hand to roll on. The reason why I don't do it on the palm of my hand is because the palm of my hand is a lot more hotter, and I will find that they become stickier quicker. So I'm just going to place these balls randomly onto these cookies. If you have any questions, you can ask away, but the downside of a live Facebook is I can only see two at a time because I've reduced the amount of comments on the page, so I don't have to get interrupted. But if you want to ask me questions, I will do a Q&A at the end, and I also want to show you how I make my flexi smoothers. Okay. Now, once I've done that, can you see I've got all my balls onto the fondant? I'm going to lay my plastic sheet on there. And then I've got a couple of options. I can use my smoother and I can flatten them. Okay. I can also use my flexi smoother. And I've just picked up one. Let me drop that back in there. But I can also use my flexi smoother and push that down. I can also, if I want to, use the sheet again and just lightly roll, okay? And that makes them a little bit more oval. Now you can take that technique further. These are bows for a cake. And can you see, I've done a nice cute polka dot effect. So what I did was I rolled out my rectangles, I laid my dots on top, I laid some white, some black, and then I laid some black on top of the white and white on top of the black. So can you see, it almost looks like a Mickey Mouse style, okay? So we call it onlaying. Some people call it applique, but it's like double layering of colors. Okay, so. Back to these beautiful cookies. Are we back in camera view? I think we are. Okay, So now I am going to just gently release the fondant back off the sheet. I'm going to get the square cutter. I'm going to push down, give it a slight wiggle, and I'm just going to take that excess off. So I've got a nice clean sheet of a piece of fondant. With my cookie now, I'm just going to lay it, pick it up gently, and I'm going to lay it on top in position, okay? And then using my flexi smoother, I've got a smooth side and I've got a frosted side. The frosted side is a little bit more grippy. That is more smoothy. So I'm just going to use that just to smooth it and make sure it's not overhanging. And you can just neaten up those edges as you go. Can you see that looks nice and Christmassy? Okay. I'm going to do the same on here. Just going to pop that between my spaces. Perfect. And then using the cutter, I'm going to cut out. Push down, give it a wiggle, and then release that fondant. Okay. And then very gently lift that up and then lay this in position. If you find that it has shrunken a little bit, you can just tease it, okay? And then lay it down, okay? Place it gently rather than sort of, you know, dumping it down, okay? So next I'm going to show you how to make the Tiffany bow. So a little cute Tiffany bow. So any questions? I think I've got some questions here. No questions as yet. That's good. Well, it's not good. Ask away. Okay, so how do I make my little Tiffany bows? They are really easy to make. Now, there's a fantastic tool that you can use, and I'm going to show you it. Not everyone may have it, but I will show you how it works. Okay, now it's called an FMM ribbon cutter, but if you don't have that, you can simply use a ruler and a pizza wheel. Now with the ribbon cutter, it's made by a company called FMM, and it comes with two other wheels with it. So one does a fluted pattern and one does a stitched effect. And you can adjust it to fit any size that you want it to cut out to. So I'm just going to put that spacer on. I'm going to put that wheel in and I'm going to put a small spacer in between, and then I'm going to have the perfect size ribbon. Now I'm just going to tighten the nut up so it's not too loose. I'm just going to get some white fondant. Now we can do those bows in all different colours. We could do the bows in red, we could do the bows in green, we can do all sorts. But I think the white looks really, really lovely. So the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to just knead the fondant. I'm going to roll out a bigger piece. And I'm going to roll it into a sausage, okay? Because really I need to create some strips. I'm going to put the seam underneath and I'm going to widen it, okay? And then I'm going to put it upright and I'm going to roll it from north to south. Using my spacers, I'm going to roll out again, making sure that the fondant's not too thick. That's a perfect thickness, okay? Now, I'm going to top and tail it, and I actually want to make it a little bit thinner, okay? So using my rolling pin, I'm going to roll north to south And for each cookie that you make, approximately you need one length that's 9 inches long. It's going to give you a little bit too much. But for every single cookie that you make, you need to make sure that you have a length of a rolling pin per strip. Okay. Now, what's awesome about the ribbon cutter is that you can hold it, and you can hold it nice and firm. And I start from the top and I bring it all the way down to my tummy. And whoever invented it really thought about cake decorating, because they've got little dots on them. And if you roll out your fondant too thick, it will actually mark it. Now, if you didn't have a ribbon cutter and you didn't have that tool, you could simply just cut it to, you know, eye it and then cut out your strip, okay? But realistically, you want to make sure you cut them out evenly and you don't have strips this big and then strips that narrow. They've all got to be the same, okay? And for each cookie, you need each one to be the length of your rolling pin. They all have to be at least the length of your rolling pin, okay? And again, when I do this, I store these in Netta files. I don't store the rolling pin on the floor though. Now, I place the strips good side up, so the good side is facing up and the rougher side underneath is not facing up. So again, use a piece of your kitchen paper towel. We're going to use a small amount of water, and I'm going to paint a line of water across the center of the cookie, okay? And then very gently, I'm going to lift my strip up and I'm going to attach it from one side to the other. And use your small scissors, just snip, okay? And then with your water, you're going to do another line that way and another line that way. And you're going to lay this on top and you're going to snip. And you should still have a good sized piece of fondant spare. That is going to go back on your sheet and you're going to put the sheet back on top. The sheet on top stops it from drying out, okay? So that's the first one. I'm going to repeat and do the same. So I'm going to paint a line. Now, when we load up our brushes in water, we kind of get a bit too generous. I want you to think of a drought, okay? Not much water. Tap it and wipe it. Draw a line across the water. Carefully lift up your edge. Lay it. If it's not nice and neat, use your scissors to neaten that, okay? Lightly press it down and then use your scissors, okay? This time we're going to put the water opposites. Now, sometimes when people make these cookies, they don't do the cross. And I think this looks so nice for sort of Christmas, you know. So, beautiful. Okay. We got some thumbs up. So, we got two lovely little cookies. Okay. Now, the next thing that we're going to do, we are going to put a small amount of water in the center of each cookie. Okay. Julie says it's one of her most popular tools, favourite tools. Me too, Julie. I could not live without it. That sounds very dramatic. I use it all the time to make my ruffles, all sorts. Okay? So, yeah. Now, I've got my off cut. Now, what I want to do is I want to turn it upside down and I want it to dangle both sides. And I don't want it to dangle too much one side and not enough the other, but I also don't want it to be too long in dangling. You're going to go, what's she saying about dangling? But basically what I want is probably about 2 to 3 mils of dangling either side. So I'm going to use my scissors and just neaten that up, okay? And then we are going to put a small amount of water in the middle, and I'm going to turn this round and I'm going to curve it up into a loop. And I'm going to sit it upright. I want it to sit like that, next to each other, not like that. So up, okay? I'm going to turn it round. You should get a good camera angle shot of this. I'm going to curve this up with my finger. And I'm going to bring that point up. Can you see? Beautiful. I'm going to do the same with the other one. But guess what? I scrunched up my piece that I just put over there. Hey, we need a rewind. We don't really need a rewind. And I need a new rolling pin as well. My one just dropped to the floor. If Nicholas Lodge gets to watch this, Nicholas, can you send me out one of your rolling pin rests? I quite like them. I doubt he's watching. So I'm just going to roll out another piece. And I always make sure it's the length of my rolling pin. Okay, so each one has to be 9 inches long. And then release your fondant. And I will start at the top. Julie, I don't know about you, I see some people cutting from the bottom, but I actually always bring it down towards my tummy, and then I remove my surplus, okay? Now, for the bow, I'm going to repeat again. So I'm going to put a tiny little bit of water in the middle, which I've done already, and I'm going to dangle this, and I've turned it upside down. The reason why I've turned it upside down is because I want the good sides to come back up on themselves, okay? So make sure it's dangling, just a little bit of a dangle. Don't make the dangles too long. Or I should call them an overhang, shouldn't I? A little bit of water in the middle. And then what I do is I just gently lift this up and I curve it up. Okay, and I turn it round and then I lift it up. And I curve it up and I lay it back down. I want to make sure both the circles are also the same size as well. Okay. Now for the middle part of the bow, the center part, I actually make it a little bit narrower. So if it's the same thickness as all the bows, it looks too chunky. So normally You'd only have about that much left over, okay? So I'm exaggerating because I cheated and made another one. You can tell I'm from England when I say cheated. I sound very London-y today. Okay, so what I've done is I've narrowed it down. So I've reduced the width of it. And then what I like to do, I don't want to put any water on the bow yet. I want to pick this up and I want to lay it down. And I want to just gently tap it over, okay? I don't want to cut it or mark it or anything. I just want to... And then I'm just going to get another little knife. And then using my crank palette knife, I'm just going to mark it. Gently take that off. And then where you see your mark, just use your pizza wheel and trim that. Now again, we're going to just put a tiny amount of water both sides of where those bows are going to connect, okay? And then what I like to do, I like to curve it over and I like to lay it one side and gently pop it onto the other, okay? And so do the same with your second one. If you've just joined me, you might go, well, why does she keep using kitchen paper towel? It just protects the cookies. It doesn't, you know, dent them or chip them or break them. So I just use a knife to mark it, okay? And then take that off. Use your pizza wheel cutter. Tiny amount of water either side of your bow. Just going to re-straighten that bow up a little bit. And then curve this round and you're going to lay it over one side to the other. Now for whatever reason, that bow, there she goes, beautiful. I tend to, because I've got dainty hands, not really, I tend to use my brushes to help me guide things in. Okay. So now I've got two little cute bows. I've got a very, very cute little Christmas bauble and I've got a very, very cute Christmas tree. Now, last but not least, I want to show you something. Hi, who've we got watching? Oh, we got a few people watching. So, and I'm going to ask you to share this to your Facebook page or any Facebook groups that you might belong to. Because what I want to do is I'm going to put the links up in a minute. There's going to be a free downloadable tutorial with step-by-step instructions on how to make all this. And what I want to do is I'm going to put it to a link to one of my lovely friends, Mel. And Mel has been a student of mine for about 9 years now, Mel. She is the gold points flyer. But this year, Mel got diagnosed with the big C, and she's had an operation, but now she's ongoing with some treatment. And a group of her friends and her family have done a fundraiser. So I really would love you to perhaps make a donation to Mel's fund, even if it's $5 or $10 or whatever you feel comfortable with. But if you download the tutorial, I really would love you to make a donation to Mel's fund. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I did a gingerbread tutorial and I had over 90 downloads and I just charged $5, you know, which is minimal, really. And everyone sent me messages back going, wow, it's fantastic, loved it, you know. But this tutorial that I've done, and it's actually a 6-page tutorial. Where's my folder gone? Hiding somewhere. But it's a 6-page tutorial, and it's going to have, well, it's not going to, it's got the recipe for the vanilla cookies that I've used today. It's also got the recipe for the piping gel, and it's got the step-by instructions on how to do the gingerbread, the Christmas tree, the little parcels, and also the little baubles. So it's a 7-page downloadable PDF. And I'm going to put the link up once I publish this. I've already put it up already in a previous post. But I really feel that if we can help our friends and our family, then we need to, you know. And Mel's got huge ongoing expenses, you know. I noticed that she's almost there on her target, but she's got about another 15 grand worth of ongoing treatment, you know. And here in Australia, we do have private health funds, but there's only so much they kick into. And it's times like this, then we need to rally together. And I would like to rally together and help Mel in raising that money. So I want to do one more thing, share one more thing with you. Cake smoothers, flexi cake smoothers. Now, when I was a little kid, and that was many years ago, I used to use ice cream lids to smooth my fondant over. So we used to have shares in, I think it was Lion's ice cream, and a bit of an addiction, but really I wanted the lids off the ice cream to use as a smoother. And as a little kid, I used to make peppermint creams, and I used to make like a fondant peppermint, and I'd dip them in chocolate and eat them and share them with the family. But I want to show you how I make my flexi smoothers, okay? Now, I know you can buy them on the market, but I've actually been making this style for probably about 20 years, and I want to show you how I make them. So, I'm going to need a pair of scissors, and I need a chopping board. So, here in sunny Australia, we have flexi chopping boards, okay? And you can buy them in most cookware shops. They are only about $2 for a pack of two. Bargain, okay? And they're called a flexi chopping board. You can buy them in red, blue, green, yellow, because they are color coordinated to what you're chopping with. But you can also buy the clear ones, okay? And what I do is I get my chopping board, or my flexi chopping board, and I use a pair of scissors, and I simply cut a rectangle out. Now, these are food safe because they're used for, you know, cutting food up. And then what I normally do is I just get my scissors and I round off the corners. Don't worry, I'm cleaning up afterwards, okay? So what's awesome about them is they are smooth one side and they are slightly opaque and a bit rougher on the other side. And I use these all the time for sharpening my edges, for smoothing my cookies, as you just saw. I use a big smoother and then another smoother on top to get my sharp edges. But I make all my flexi smoothers out of my chopping boards. So I hope you've enjoyed this tutorial. I hope I'm going to encourage you to make these delicious cookies. I'm off to put the kettle on now and scoff them, really, but no. But I hope you've enjoyed my tutorial. And I encourage you to get cooking and baking with the family, with the kids, with yourself, you know. And I look forward to sharing more stuff with you in the new year. So thank you for watching. It has gone on for a good hour and a bit, but hopefully it's been a good hour and a bit. I do ask you to share this once you've watched it. And if you haven't liked our page, please like our page. But I really encourage you to download the tutorial and make a donation to Mel's, because Mel really needs help in getting those big fees come down, you know. So and at the end of the day, if we can help, you know, let's just help, you know. And I just thought, this time I won't do it as a paid tutorial. You can download it for free, but you know, go onto Mel's link and make a donation if you can, you know. And if you can't, you can't. So wherever you might be in Australia or in the world, America, England, have a lovely Christmas, everyone. And I'm off to eat a little cookie and have a nice cup of coffee. So thank you for joining, and please feel free to share this. And happy Christmas and New Year to everyone. Thank you. Bye.